Imagine that you were a kid in the 1980s. You didn't have cable television like a significant minority of Americans had in that time frame, so all you had were three channels to tune into: ABC, NBC, and CBS. And maybe a few independent stations that relied on syndicated programming and local news, but I digress. Anywho, most children's programming would be broadcasted on Saturday mornings, with each network having a flagship program. NBC had the Smurfs, ABC had Scooby-Doo and the Super Friends, and CBS had Muppet Babies and the Bugs Bunny Show. All that changed when syndication came along, with G.I. Joe, Transformers, and He-Man dominating the airwaves. And then comes the end of the program. You recognize the logo at the end of the program that represents the company behind it. Hanna-Barbera, that swirling star you've seen at the end of those programs, has endeared many, even though they produced way too many shows during that time period. Filmation, those colorful letters in Westinghouse typeface to reflect the new owners. The shittiest goddamn company to come out of that era. Sumba Marvel, actually a partnership between two studios to produce licensed animated Hasbro product, a rarity at that time. They kicked ass, although Marvel produced many notable solo projects on their own, such as Dungeons & Dragons, Muppet Babies, and Spider-Man. I guess that's all the companies I can think of. Wait, there's one more company I forgot to list. And I'm covering this company too? Holy shit, then what is it? Oh, Christ. Years ago, some random-ass French dude wanted to drive his ambition to create an advertising company based out of a suburb of Paris, France. Fast forward to a decade later, and the company becomes the largest producer of animated programming in the United States of America. This is the story of a company that had its glorious days in the 1980s, with the genius minds of Jean-Charles Lopin, Andy Hayward, and Chaim Saban operating behind the scenes. These days of contentment ended in the 1990s, with the biggest offenders being Sit back and enjoy the history of this ambitious creator of animated content. This is the rise and fall of DIC Entertainment. Our story begins on the 31st of May, 1950, in Tours, France. Not much happens there, except our main man, Jean-Charles Lopin, was brought into this world. Not much was known about his childhood, but in 1968, by the age of 18 years old, he creates his own advertising agency, which he names, say it with me folks, Office de Gestion et d'Action Publicitaire, or the OGAP. Its primary focus was to create advertising films for television. As much as that sounded, it was not simple. The agency practically operated as a small movie studio, in which scenarios were written for commercials and were distributed through UGC Circuit A. The complexities of the job did not overwhelm the then teenage Chalopin, who in 1971 wanted to make his company fully realized. With the financial backing of Radio Television Luxembourg, the OGAP became a division of the company, and was thus renamed Diffusion Information Commercial, or DIC. Despite taking the next step forward, DIC was still an advertising company at this point. But now that it was financially secure, Chalopin can have his cake, eat it, and have a million more cakes. Around this time, Chalopin no longer wanted to make his commercials live action. He felt that making an animated commercial would be more cost-efficient and less labor-intensive, giving a whole new meaning for the DIC acronym, Do It Cheap. An animation studio was set up in Tours, where the agency was based, and all they did was, you know, animated commercials for their clients. They didn't really produce any animated programs around this time. until 1980. In 1977, Italian-French cartoonist Bruno Bianchi joined the Tour studio, which in 3 years was about to have a sister studio in Paris. While he considered to be DIC's idea man, Bianchi was the driving force behind DIC's embedded future. In 1980, he was given the honor to create two of DIC's first programs for television, one of which was called Crow e Blotto. It's about a caveman called Crow, who is trying to hunt a brontosaurus in which his plans backfire. The series is similar to Wile E, Coyote, and Roadrunner, except with a caveman and a brontosaurus. Another show that premiered alongside Crow e Blotto was the educational Archibald le Magicien. In the show, Archibald is a magician who has transformed himself into a dog and can't remember how to change himself back. Fail! He befriends a young boy named Pierre and teaches him the secrets of maintaining a good form and health. The series was designed to teach child viewers how to take care of their health. Among its many educational values were the dangers of using tobacco, alcohol, exposure to the sun, and the importance of maintaining one's hygiene such as brushing one's teeth, exercising, washing one's hands, and eating balanced meals. So, to sum it up, Archibald is McGruff the crime dog, except that he's a creepy pedophile Saint Bernard with a mustache. Freaking ew. This show is incredibly hard to find along with its sister series. Predetermined factors that I can think of is the fact that they were both short format series, much like DIC's commercials around the time, albeit slightly longer. This proved to be a major disadvantage later on, due to the fact that half-hour-long series typically draw more advertising dollars. In fact, when these shows aired, they were never seen again. From this point on, Diffusion Information, a commercial, had its name changed to Diffusion Information et Communication ever since delving into television production. Its production division, DIC Audiovisual, was founded when the animation studio was opened in Paris. DIC's next program was its first half-hour program, called Ulysses 31. It's pretty much an update of the Greek mythology of Odysseus, known as Ulysses in Latin, to the 31st century. Why the 31st century? Well, you know. The story describes the struggles of Ulysses and his crew against the divine entities that rule the universe, the ancient gods from Greek mythology. The gods of Olympus are angered when Ulysses, commander of the giant spaceship Odyssey, kills the giant Cyclops to save a group of enslaved children, including his son. Zeus sends Ulysses to travel the universe with this crew frozen until he finds the kingdom of Hades, at which point his crew will be revived and he will be able to return to Earth. Along the way, they encounter numerous other famous figures from Greek mythology who have been given a futuristic twist. 26 episodes were produced. Despite the obvious gimmick, the show is pretty generic, but I do gotta give props to the animation, which is really good at the time for television, and that's saying a lot. The characters are not fully realized. Ulysses is a generic hero, Telemachus is an annoying male damsel, and his friend?
A robot all your own. Here, maybe you'd like to munch on a small bowl.
The show is also an obvious ripoff of Star Wars, with swords being replaced with lightsabers, and that annoying robot being a mix of CP-3PO and R2-D2. And not to mention, George Lucas even sued DIC for using a piece of music that sounded similar to Star Wars. Despite that, the music is pretty good, which is typical of early DIC productions. And the storytelling was a refreshing change in dynamics from this typical Scooby-Doo Smurf formula that was popular at that time. Overall, the show was very good for its time, but it hasn't aged well, unfortunately. Ulysses 31 was broadcast on France 3 from October 10, 1981 to April 3, 1982. And despite it being the first full-length DIC production, it was not broadcast in the States until 1986. Ulysses 31 was DIC's first collaboration with a very well-known anime company called Tokyo Movie Shinsha, or TMS. They provided the best animation for DIC, and they were their first overseas animation partner. TMS would later become more well-known as the animation producer for shows such as DuckTales and Animaniacs. Moving right along, TMS saw the potential in the success in Ulysses 31 and desperately wanted to bring the success of Lupin III to the West. It was already successful in Italy, but TMS wanted to take their success in Europe even further. They revisited the concept used in Ulysses 31 by taking a modern character and supplanting them into the future again. And thus, Lupin VIII was born, a tale of the Arsène Lupin of the 22nd century, who, instead of partaking into the trade of thievery, works as a roguish private eye operating out of an airship above a futuristic Paris. Various anime greats worked on this pilot, including Rin Taro, the director of Osamu Tezuka's Metropolis. Production was going great until they ran into a little problem. Copyright. The Arsène Lupin series was created by Maurice LeBlanc and centered around a master thief. When manga artist Monkey Punch created Lupin III in 1967, he didn't even bother consulting with the estate to use the Lupin name. Copyright law in Japan was very lenient, so he was allowed to do this, but when the Lupin franchise caught on worldwide, the estate wanted a piece of the pie. The estate demanded a large sum of money from the producers, which was not going to be mutually agreed upon, and as a result, production was shut down. Ironically, the animation and soundtrack was completed, but voice work was not produced. It's a damn shame that this pilot was unfinished, because the whole project looks amazing. The animation is done quite well, not to mention layout and background design. They really went all out in this production. The story is there, but it's not being told to the viewer, since there's no voiceover track. TMS released this special on DVD in Japan with Japanese subtitles, so the dialogue cannot be interpreted. Looking at the special, it looks surprisingly faithful to the 1977 incarnation of Lupin III, with its zany and diverse cast of characters and its out-there scenarios and gags. It's a damn shame that this pilot didn't make it to series, because this would have been easily the best DIC production not to be produced in America. The last DIC production to come out of France exclusively is another DIC production co-produced in Japan, The Mysterious Cities of Gold. Its premise was basically Johnny Quest meets, Clutch Cargo? Anyways, this show was animated by Studio Pierrot, best known for such anime as Urusei Yatsura, Bleach, Naruto, and Yu Yu Hakusho. To me, it's considered a step down from Ulysses 31, and the English voice acting is very mediocre. Anywho, it was okay for its time, but nowadays it's extremely meh, and it doesn't hold a candle to Ulysses 31. This show first aired in Luxembourg on the 13th of May, 1982, by RTL Television, and in France on the 26th of September, 1983, by Antenna 2. It was subsequently redubbed and distributed in many different countries throughout the world. Much like Ulysses 31, it wasn't broadcast in the US until 1986, this time on Nickelodeon. Around the time Mysterious Cities aired, Deke wanted to do something very ballsy. They were already moderately successful in their native country with their action-adventure cartoons. However, they suddenly realized that they would turn even more profit if they direct their focus to the largest animation market in the world, the United States. Over there, the absolute dominator of animated programs in the States is Hanna-Barbera, a landmark television production company founded by William Hanna and Joseph Barbera, who created programs that became very recognizable in pop culture, such as The Flintstones, Johnny Quest, Yogi Bear, and their most famous creation, Scooby-Doo. They were also the creators of MGM's Tom and Jerry, one of the standard animation series during animation's golden age. They were in a major creative decline that started in the 1970s. Practically 70% of their animated product were Scooby-Doo clones. Such quote-unquote classics like Jabberjaw, Goober and the Ghost Chasers, Funky Phantom, Speed Buggy, The Amazing Chan and the Chan Clan, Butch Cassidy and the Sundance Kids, Inch High, Private Eye, Cool Club, Buford Files, Josie and the Pussycats, Captain Caveman and the Teen Angels, Wonder Wheels, Saw My Ass Good, and the list goes on. By the time Hanna-Barbera was in a creative crisis, they launched a series that was considered to be one of the biggest hits of the decade, which is the Smurfs. From that point on, HB began ripping itself off even more like it did during the previous decade, with more shows revolving around a civilization of cute creatures, such as the Snorks, the Biscuits, Munch Cheese, Shirt Tales, The Fuck Nuggets, and once again, the list goes on. In this crowded-ass field of animated fodder, it had even more production companies jumping the bandwagon. Filmation, Marvel Productions, Ruby Spears, Sumbo Productions, and the newly Christian Film Roman. Pretty much all of the companies I mentioned in the intro. So how in the hell is D going to squeeze their fat ass in the competition and make themselves stand out among the rest of the crowd? We'll find out, but first, a little prehistory. When Deke wanted to expand their horizons into America, they tapped a known unknown in the industry, whose name is Andrew A. Hayward. Prior to his hiring at Deke America, he was a story man at Hanna-Barbera Productions, whose credits included Scooby's Laugh Olympics and All-New Popeye Hour. The original intention for the American arm was to translate Deke Productions into American English, in which it did later on. This original intention was scrapped when Jean Chalopin wanted to move all DIC operations into America, which is considered a very risky business move. His right-hand man and protege, Bruno Bianchi, went with him, along with their music composers, Shuki Levy and Chaim Saban. The team of Levy Saban is pretty straightforward. Shuki Levy did all the music, while Chaim Saban made the deals. The deal? DIC was allowed to use Saban's music for free, just as long as they get an undisclosed royalty fee from the program's profits. Just a year later, they launched Saban Productions, which later on became a force in children's programming in the 1990s. Anyways, the terrific trio wanted to launch an animated series that had the potential of blowing any popular show around that time out of the water. They initially chose to syndicate the show due to the crowded climate of the Saturday morning schedule around that time. Fortunately, they were able to find a distributor in LBS, which stood for Lexington Broadcast Services. They were a barter syndicator much in the vein as the Program Exchange, except they only distributed just a few programs before they stuck a deal with DIC. For the first program, Hayward developed an idea for a crime-solving series, which was tweaked by Chalopin into the series we know today. Bianchi became the overall designer of the series, as well as its supervising director. The title character went through a whopping 350 redesigns before reaching the final product. The name of the show? Inspector Gadget. Inspector Gadget is a famous cyborg police inspector with the seemingly endless amount of gadgets he can summon by saying "Go, go, Gadget," then the gadget's name. Despite having all this equipment, Gadget is usually incompetent and clueless, and overcomes obstacles and survives perilous situations often by sheer good luck. He is also helped by his niece Penny, an intelligent dog Brain, who both secretly help him solve each case. The series stars Don Adams as the titular character, and veteran Hanna-Barbera voice actor Frank Welker as Dr. Claw. Looking at this series, there's no telling that it's a spoof of 1960s detective slash espionage shows that were being syndicated in the US around that time, like Mission Impossible and Mannix. The show is also heavily influenced by Get Smart. That series also stars Don Adams as a bumbling detective. At the time, the show has been viewed as being a refreshing change in an animation market crowded with merchandise-driven shows, not to mention tried and tired formulas that are only held by their cheese factor. The animation is fairly good for its time. We actually get to see some fluid movement and subtle poses, courtesy of TMS. The show's jokes and gags are nice as well. You can tell they have a fair amount of inspiration in them. And the voice acting is done very well. Don Adams as Inspector Gadget is about as iconic as a character could be, and Frank Welker hammers it home with three roles: Dr. Claw, Mad Cat, and Brain. Don Adams and Frank Welker did their recording separately in Los Angeles, while the rest of the voice cast recorded their lines in Canada. Veteran Canadian voice actor Dan Hennessy voices Chief Quimby, while a then 13-year-old Cree Summer voices Penny in her voice acting debut. And the intro is one of the best animated intros in the 1980s. The theme song composed by Shuki Levy and Chaim Saban perfectly captures the mood of this cartoon. It's a goofy adventurous affair. And now it's time to talk about the cons. The show might be different from other cartoons in this era, but like all the others, it operated on a basic formula. One, Gadget is seen spending time with his niece Penny and his dog Brain. Two, Gadget receives a mission from Chief Quimby, inferring him about Dr. Claw and the organization MAD and their latest scheme to take over the world. The message blows up, a reference to Mission Impossible, and Quimby is somehow affected by the explosion. Inspector Gadget finds a way to thwart MAD and gets in trouble. Penny and Brain save Gadget from peril. MAD's plans are foiled. Cute catchphrase by Dr. Claw.
I will get you next time, Inspector Gadget. Next time.
Excuse me. Gadget is then congratulated for his efforts. This formula made it easier for Deke to churn out episodes faster than pancakes at IHOP, even at the expense of the overall quality of the episodes, which were prone to dip every once in a while. Some of the show's writing hasn't aged well either. I bet there really was a time when cheesy puns and lame mom jokes were all the rave back in cartoons like this. Anyways, watching an episode once could grant you an entire experience of Inspector Gadget, which can be both a good thing and a bad thing. People that prefer shows to not have continuity can jump in one point of the show at any time, without having to know what went on in the previous episodes. However, binge watching the show can become very tiresome at times, as the predictability of the show's gags and plot points can be entirely noticeable. Oh, and I almost forgot about the PSAs. They're a bit jarring like all the others that were on other shows.
Lakes are really nice.
But always remember, they can be very deep, so never swim out too far.
Ah! He's full of shit!
Overall, Inspector Gadget is a solid debut for Deke Enterprises, even though it's not that great. Did I enjoy it despite its visible flaws? Of course I do! These characters are engaging enough to the point that I can really be allowed to be entertained. It's a good show, but it's not a masterpiece. Inspector Gadget made its debut in syndication with the pilot on the 4th of December 1982, with the regular series premiering on the 12th of September 1983. It premiered to overall great ratings and was a worldwide smash. It was also the first animated series to premiere in stereo sound.
I have a very special secret. I'm the only one who knows about tiny people living in our walls called the Littles.
The next show produced by Deke was made during the development of Inspector Gadget, except that it made its debut 2 days earlier, due mostly in part to 13 episodes being produced for the first season, compared to Inspector Gadget 65. The Littles was the first show Deke produced for network television, making its debut on the 10th of September 1983 on American Broadcasting Company. The show is based on a series of books by American author John Peterson, the first of which was published in 1967. At first glance, I've looked at this series and said to myself, oh god, another Smurfs ripoff. And it is. There's a way to sum up the similarities it has to the Smurfs, and I'll explain it like this. The show revolves around impish creatures that want to avoid being captured by a larger human, who wants them for some ulterior motive. They also occasionally go on adventures, well, just cause. There's the plot of the show, as well as the Smurfs. Which one came first and is worth watching? The Smurfs. This show sucks ass. The animation, done by TMS, looks pretty anime at times, except it's not good anime. The voice acting can be quite terrible. At times, it looks like they just pull people off of the street to record some lines. And the storylines are so basic. You don't have to be original, but there's not a trace of what makes this show unique. Also, this show has the tendency to find an inopportune time to force a moral down your throat. And there is an episode where some random character is addicted to prescription drugs. Oh my god, just watch this clip. It's so bum fucking hilarious.
Tastes like medicine. Oh no, that pie's alive.
Sign me the fuck up!
So there's the Littles for you. It's a rushed affair. But apparently the show became so popular that it got its own movie, released in 1985. Hell, Inspector Gadget didn't get his own animated movie during this time, but he eventually did get one, and we'll definitely talk about that later. Now that the first year is over with, it's time to move on to the second year, 1984. This year, Inspector Gadget and the Littles are continuing their runs on television, while DIC churned out 6 more TV shows during this period, all but one of them being established franchises that were licensed to be produced by the production company. All the animation companies at this point had engaged in this practice in the 1970s and the 1980s, with Hanna-Barbera and especially Filmation being the biggest culprits. Could DIC pull off the same amount of success that they had? Let's find out. First, we start off with the Get Along Gang. Oh boy. This was DIC's first production for the CBS television network, a network that they would have a special relationship with later on. The series is based on a series of greeting cards from American Greetings, the same company that made Care Bears and Strawberry Shortcake. Now what you have on the surface is what is seemingly a sweet and saccharine, mostly harmless cartoon. This was the golden standard at the time because television watchdog groups had a sizable influence on broadcast television around this time, with only a few animated series being allowed to slip by, as long as they had an educational PSA at the end. The series' overall message is to always get along. Teamwork is the way to go, and friendship is important, love thy neighbor, so on and so forth. This message means well and all, but its methods on trying to approach it is flawed. Severely flawed. The Get Along Gang strongly emphasizes group harmony over individualism in order to keep the person who disagrees in check. Therefore, the group is always right, the complainer is always wrong. 80s television animation writer Mark Evanier, who was then writing for a Marvel production called Dungeons & Dragons, commented on this situation. This was the message of far too many 80s cartoon shows. If all your friends want to go get pizza and you want a burger, you should bow to the will of the majority and go get pizza with them. There was even a show for one season on CBS called The Get Along Gang, which was dedicated unabashedly to this principle. Each week, whichever member of the gang didn't get along with the others learned the error of his or her ways. I don't believe you should always go along with the group. What about thinking for yourself? What about developing your own personality and viewpoint? What about doing things because you decide they're the right thing to do, not because the majority rule and you got outvoted? I'm going to elaborate on this comment. Basically, what the show's trying to do is to teach kids to conform to the ideals of a certain group, whether they like it or not. Conformity is not a good thing for people who want to express how they feel in a certain situation and how they want to express themselves. The show's approach to get along with people is ignorant to a certain degree and can have a far more damaging effect than what can be realized. Just look at what's happening today.
You've never experienced oppression in your entire fucking life. Neither have I. You're fucking a white male. You're a white man. I support my people. Bullshit.
Bullshit. That's what Bernie Sanders said.
Therefore, this is indeed the worst show that DIC Enterprises ever made in the 80s. Anyways, the Get Along Gang made its debut on September 15, 1984 to thankfully low ratings and ended its run on the 8th of December of that year. Unfortunately, the show would continue in reruns on CBS until 1986, no thanks to the loss of the Bugs Bunny show in 1985. The Get Along Gang will continue in reruns on various networks until 2001. Oh, Jesus. The next show for 1984 is Wolf Rock TV, which stars Wolfman Jack as a TV host who hosts a TV program with 3 teenagers and a parrot. Yeah. Live-action music videos are shown throughout the show, jumping on the MTV bandwagon, which was really, really popular at the time. I would talk about this show, except that the show hasn't been seen in its entirety since it was first run. The reason is obvious. There are rights issues surrounding the music videos used in each episode. If the music videos are taken out, there would only exist the segments which only make up a small fraction of the episode. This is the only DIC cartoon in existence that is completely missing because of this. Wolf Rock TV aired on ABC from September 8th to October 20th, 1984 for 7 episodes, where it was canceled due to low ratings. This is notable because it's practically Deke's first dud. Wow. The next two shows produced by DIC are Kid Video, an animation live-action hybrid co-production with the newly established Saban Entertainment, and their first show for NBC. In Pole Position, an adaptation that's also not an adaptation, for CBS. Kid Video lasted for two seasons on NBC and was moved to CBS for reruns, where Pole Position only lasted for 13 episodes. In 1980, a then-unknown company called Ruby Spears made a show called Heathcliff and Dingbat, a half-hour-long show that showcased the comic strip Cat and an in-house produced character, who was eventually replaced with Marmaduke. A trait that was unique to this show was that it was legendary voice actor Mel Blanc's final original role, as he played Heathcliff. The show was canceled after two seasons. Fast forward 2 years later, another adaptation was commissioned. Everybody's favorite orange cat, until Garfield arrived of course, is featured in a more faithful adaptation of the comic strip, with a few added characters that were collectively known as the Cadillac Cats. Unlike in the previous series, we finally got to see Heathcliff flip trash cans onto cats, steal fish from fish shops, and pick fights with the neighborhood dog. You know, actually do mischievous stuff, which was the reason why he was created. And to make matters even better, he is still voiced by Mel Blanc. Heathcliff is usually accompanied by the core three members of the Cadillac Cats, which are Hector, Mungo, and Wordsworth. After the Heathcliff segment, the core three of the Cadillac Cats will serve under the head cheese of the group, Riff Raff, and his trophy girlfriend Cleo always by his side. Their segments revolved around Riff Raff's get-rich-quick schemes or searches for food. I'm going to have to say that this is my personal favorite show that DIC produced during their early period. It's humorous, colorful, and downright entertaining. Mel Blanc as Heathcliff is such a huge addition to the show. His lines, at times not that funny, always make me laugh for some reason. Maybe it's due to his delivery, just maybe. The animation can be quite good at times, but it can get in the way of the show's pacing. And the Cadillac Cat segments are funny as well. They show an established formula can also work, because of the possibilities that won't make it seem tiring, unlike Inspector Gadget. Overall, the show is great. It has a catchy theme song, great characters, and an overall great presentation. Easy 8 out of 10. Heathcliff debuted on September 5th, 1984 in syndication, where it enjoyed good ratings and lasted until 1988. It reran on various networks until 1999 on Fox Family. It was also rerun on this TV in 2000. The next show DIC produced is one I'm sure you all remember, and that's Rainbow Bright. Or, as they call it in Japan, Maho Shoujo Rainbow Bright! The show was made around the same time Hallmark Cards made a deal with toy company Mattel to make physical merchandising of the characters. Coincidence, huh? Not really. This show is about a girl named Rainbow Bright, who's in charge of the colors of the universe. She adopts this title when she rescued the Color Kids from the clutches of the evil King of Shadows, who wants to rid the world of the various wavelengths of the light spectrum. Pretty generic plot, but at times there could be a surprising amount of adventure in these stories. This glorified commercial premiered as a syndicated primetime special on the 27th of June 1984, with two more two-part specials premiering in December of that same year, and April 1985. In 1986, 8 more episodes were produced for a grand total of 13 episodes. And in the year before that, a theatrical movie was released in theaters by Warner Brothers. To sum it up, this is an extended episode of the television series in widescreen. Speaking of 1985, we now move into this year. Gadget, The Littles, and Heathcliff both continue their runs. Kid Video also finishes their run on NBC and continues in reruns on there. The former two series have already, by this time, revamped their formats. For Gadget, the episodes will feature 3 episodes in a row, sharing the same general theme. Many of these episodes simply revolved around Mad trying to get rid of Gadget, rather than Dr. Claw's spectacular crimes and plots to dominate the world from the first season. New characters and settings were introduced. Gadget, Penny, and Brain moved into a high-tech house filled with many gadgets, where a few of the episodes were actually located. Penny spent much less screen time solving Mad's crimes, In the season's fourth episode, Corporal Caveman was introduced as Gadget's sidekick. He's as much as a bumbling idiot as Gadget, but will come useful in Gadget's adventures. For the littles, they will just travel. Yeah, they're on vacation. Hope they get lost in the jungle for all I care. The first show that DIC produced from 1985 is, well, The Care Bears!
The Care Bears.
Ooh. The series picked up from where the theatrical movie left off, which was released in March of the same year. The premise of the show is about a group of bears that are sent to Earth to help children who are in need of an uplift. You know, those type of kids who think the whole world is against them. Yeah, those type of kids. Yeah, another show loaded with sugar, colors, and blatant toy promotion. DIC only produced 11 episodes of this iteration. The remaining 49 were produced by Nelvana. Speaking of, let me talk about Nelvana for a second. In the early days, Nelvana had quite the relationship with DIC. They co-produced the first season of Inspector Gadget with the company, as well as producing a pilot for the Get Along game before handing the torch onto DIC. It may be as much of a stretch as I thought it would be, but Nelvana could be credited as one of the main reasons DIC has such a smooth landing in the Americas. And in turn, vice versa. The Care Bears turned out to be the biggest hit for Nelvana in the 1980s, and the fact that DIC handed production of the series to Nelvana might be a blessing in disguise. Other shows that DIC produced in 1985 were Jason and Wheel Warriors, a syndicated space opera built around a hero living on an Agrarian planet, who was in predictable conflict with an anti-ecological villain wanting to strip mine the place for profit. This was the first syndicated DIC show to not be distributed by LBS Communications. Instead, it was distributed by the SFM Media Corporation, who you may know for distributing that Grandma Got Run Over by a Reindeer TV special. Oh my god. The other show that was produced was Hulk Hogan's Rockin' Wrestling, co-produced by the World Wrestling Federation for CBS. If you thought what the WWE is doing to Hanna-Barbera right now is excruciatingly absurd, you can trace it back to this wonderfully crude TV show. The show lasted two seasons and was reran until 1987. The main show that DIC created in 1985 gave G.I. Joe and Transformers a run for their money, Mask, based off a toy line from Kenner, which would later be acquired by Tonka Toys. The show is focused around the Mobile Armored Strike Command, operated under the leadership of Matt Tracker, and is engaged in an ongoing battle against the vicious evil network of Mayhem, or Venom. The show has an emphasis on superpower masks worn by the characters on the show, as well as the transforming vehicles the characters operate. As cool as this show is, it would have been the most entertaining if it wasn't for that damn annoying kid and his robot sidekick. Seriously, what is up with these annoying kids and their annoying acquaintances in these type of shows? Nevertheless, it's a really cool show, and if you're able to tolerate the cuteness, it will remind you of those 80s B-action movies that Cannon Films used to make. Or DEG, Kuroko, or hell, even Orion Pictures. DIC produced 75 episodes of this series, and it was distributed by LBS. It easily became one of the more popular merchandise-driven action cartoons from the 1980s, and it's easy to see why. IGN even listed it on their top 100 animated series list at number 99.
But I thought it was so good!
And now it's time to end 1985 on quite a bittersweet note. DIC opened its own Japan-based animation facility for animation production on the shows in order to bypass overseas animation subcontractors. That means it's either a cost-cutting measure of sorts or a way for the company to provide their services independently without relying on anyone else. Either way, this meant that they had to sever their ties with TMS, their main animation subcontractor. While it's a good thing that DIC is doing their own services independently, even that wouldn't have lasted long. It would be just a few years before they would have to rely on Korean and Chinese animation studios as a cheaper means for producing material, so nothing good ever came out of that situation. I can theorize that DIC parting ways with TMS provided an opportunity for Disney and Warner Brothers to start production on their own animations for television, utilizing the same studio. And I have to say that better things did come out of that, with DuckTales, Animaniacs, Tiny Toons, and Batman being shining examples of what TMS have done for animation subcontracting. DIC cutting the cord with TMS and other Japanese studios may have been one thing, but overall quality of material suffered after that. Now we move on to 1986, which is arguably the most eventful year for DIC Enterprises. To start things off, 7 series are ending their first runs. Inspector Gadget, The Littles, Heathcliff, Rainbow Bright, Jason and Wheel Warriors, Mask, and Hulk Hogan's Rockin' Wrestling were the shows that were cleared in order to make room for more shows on a production schedule. Gadget and Heathcliff would continue reruns on Nickelodeon, while the rest would be lucky to have a spot on DIC's 90-minute programming block, Kiddio TV, which lasted from 1986 to 1988. The first show to kick off 1986 was a co-production with NBC, and boy did DIC ramp up the co-productions to the point that they didn't even own the show. The name of the show was called Kissy Fur, and it's about a bear named Gus and his son Kissy Fur, two bears that escape a circus. Gus and Kissy Fur somehow create a boat tour business to transport animals down a river. Every animal except the big bad alligators, because they're bad. Ooh. Nah, they're just pissed off because they're not allowed to be classified as regular animals because they're quote-unquote evil predators. While the bears are supposed to be the almighty protectors of the swamp, yeah, I know, it's total bullshit. That annoying little fuck Kissy Fur and his dumbass dickhead punk of a father would run on NBC until 1990. While the Care Bears continued to make waves on the ABC television network, DIC was kind of kicking itself in the head for not holding on to the license for long. So American Greetings had another crappy franchise to promote to DIC, and they followed along. The show eventually created was called Popples, and it ran in syndication with distribution by LBS. The show stars 9 fugly Care Bear rejects called Popples. They have fuzzy tails and can literally pull random shit out of their asses. I'm just kidding. They're just pouches that are located on the backside, but even then. And I'm not going to lie, these little shitheads are annoying as fuck. The first episode alone sees their caretaker get tormented by their hedonistic ways. She loses her math book, which I don't know how because that room is tidy. When those malicious rainbow-colored devil spawns offer to quote-unquote help, they trash her room, make noise, and randomly shove things in her face as if they're a math book, like they're literally taunting her.
Is this it?
That's it.
Stop it or I'll bury you alive in a box!
And one of them make the suggestion to go to the library, which he does. When she arrives, disaster arises. Those little Lucky Charm motherfuckers knock down all of the bookshelves like dominoes because of their horseplay. Then at the end of the episode, she says,
"You guys can party all night."
Hell nah! If I was her, I would kick those Roy G. Biv Cornball Wizard of Oz looking punks out of my house. Give me an F. Give me a U. Give me a C. Give me a K! What does that spell? Fuck! This show had 44 episodes produced. How? I don't know. But from here, there was a sign that there was a better product to be produced. Hopefully. And when I meant hopefully, I meant it. Behold the most successful show to ever come out of the company, The Real Ghostbusters. The show premiered in September 1986, around the same time Filmation came out with their shitty iteration of Ghostbusters, which to be fair was a revival of their 1975 live-action series that had no relation to Columbia's Ghostbusters. If ABC didn't have an anchor show other than acquiring the rights to air the Looney Tunes from CBS, then this was considered an anchor show. That's how successful it was. Anywho, the show was a continuation of the 1984 movie, and features radically different designs and voices of the main characters. In case you're living under a rock, because I am too, the main characters are bespectacled intellectual Egon Spengler, self-styled ladies' man Peter Venkman, laconic humorist Ray Stantz, common sense man and token black guy Winston Zeddemore, and eccentric secretary Janine Melnitz. As in the film, the characters offered what was essentially a high-tech extermination services for paranormal beings, and used a variety of scientifically devised means to combat them. The one standout in the cast was the team's mascot, Slimer, a green blob who had been a minor antagonist in the film. He received top billing in 1988 and kept it for the program's four remaining years on air. Columbia Pictures, which produced and distributed the film and its 1989 sequel, co-produced the series with DIC. They will also own distribution rights to the show, as well as the show's copyright. And what would DIC get in return? The satisfaction that they had a part in creating this great series. That's what. Not good for them. And now, for a brief review. This show is easily the best show DIC ever made. Hands down. This show is not only the rare cartoon from the 1980s that I actually love, it's one that I would absolutely recommend. This show has great animation, downright scary designs, and brilliant writing. This show doesn't cheese the viewer out with its corny-ass lines that had plagued the DIC library, at least in the early seasons. And do I need to mention that the voice acting is superb? Lorenzo's music as Peter Venkman just captivates me for some reason. Same with Maurice LaMarche as Egon Spengler. Yeah, I know that I'm being a fanboy right now, but the thing is, when you're watching a bunch of shows that are either mediocre and downright infuriating as you happen to come across a show that is actually legitimately good, then you'll be saying the same thing too. This absolute gem of the show lasted 141 episodes, which spanned 5 years. 65 episodes, which is the second season, were first run in syndication. It was syndicated by Coca-Cola Telecommunications. And yes, people who didn't know that, Coca-Cola once owned Columbia Pictures. The show continued on ABC until 1991. One more note before I go on to the next series. This show is listed number 22 on IGN's Top 100 Animated Series. That's pretty freaking high, and very deserving of the show too. Another note I miss is Inspector Gadget's listing at number 54. Me personally, I don't know how it got that high. It's a good show, but it's too high to be listed above the Venture Brothers, Dexter's Laboratory, and Tom and Jerry. Maybe number 72 would be considered fitting for the show's ranking. Another breakout hit DIC produced was everybody's favorite little troublemaker, until Bart Simpson dethroned him, Dennis the Menace. For you Brits out there, I'm not talking about your Dennis the Menace. Ours is more cleaner and somewhat more well-behaved. Sort of. Like the comic strip it was based on, the show is about a little boy with a mischievous personality. He constantly gets sent to timeout, makes life a living hell for his adults who are around him, and is the bane of his next-door neighbor Mr. Wilson's existence. And yes, this show is your basic DIC comedy show, as he indulges himself in wacky adventures with his friends. Whoopee. This show had a 65-episode run in syndication and a 13-episode run on CBS, and was aired alongside Inspector Gadget on that same network. The show was the first DIC program to be distributed by the Program Exchange. And now, here's another big event. And it's not even a TV show. It's a change in ownership. Andy Hayward, the head of operations of DIC Enterprises and sole champion of the success of the company, with the help of investors, led a leveraged buyout of the company from Radio Television Luxembourg and Jean Chalopin. As a result, Chalopin, Bruno Bianchi, and producer Tetsuo Katayama left the company to be replaced by Robbie London and Michael Maliani as key employees. Chalopin formed the company CND, Creativité et Développement.
Isn't that cute? But it's wrong!
Take 67, action!
Which stands for Creativité et Développement. In 1987, and continued to make animated shows during the late 80s and the 90s. The base of operations for DIC was moved to California, and the main company was renamed DIC Animation City Incorporated. Oh my god, what a stupid take on CBS Television City, or Universal City Studios for that matter. Anyways, the takeover left DIC in a financial hole, so they ended up selling the international rights to their programs to Saban International, who then had the bright idea to resell them to CND. After that development, Hayward was pissed. His relationship with Chalopin became strained afterwards, and sued him so hard until his head spun out of his tiny French body. The issue wasn't settled until 1991. There's one more thing that I have to mention before I move on, and that's Deke's live action productions. Unfortunately, due to time constraints, I will not be able to cover them in this movie. Let's move on. ...1987 brought many new shows to the DIC pantheon. The shows that needed mentioning, so they won't be brought up again, are Lady Lovely Locks, Beverly Hills Teens, Dino Saucers, Hello Kitty's Furry Tale Theater, Little Clowns of Happy Town, The New Archies, Starcom, the U.S. Space Force, and Sylvanian Families. These shows are all the same in terms of ambition. They have none. They're all contractual pieces of work that will amount to nothing but cash grab fodder. 1987 would also mark the year that DIC would sever their relationship with LBS Communications, who have been their syndication partners since their exodus to America. Ever since the success of The Real Ghostbusters, DIC had been flirting with Coca-Cola Television for a potential partnership. However, that would eventually go in the dumps as well. Columbia Pictures released a movie called Ishtar, which became a notorious bomb and put the studio in financial trouble, as they were trying to recover from a string of flops from themselves and their TriStar division. Coca-Cola by this time was trying to find a buyer for Columbia Pictures, so DIC didn't want to become involved with that debacle. Instead, they settled for a well-known company by that time frame called Cluster Television Incorporated, a division of Hasbro, who commissioned animated adaptations of G.I. Joe and Transformers, two of the biggest hits from that era. However, DIC still had multiple distribution partners after that, such as The Program Exchange, Viacom, Tribune Entertainment, Bobot Kids Network, among others. Also, around this time, DIC changed its logo to reflect a new era. Gone was the blue vortex, with the funky logo encased in it that had been used since the late 70s. Is it me, or does it look like it says DIE? Anyways, it was a somewhat eerie early CGI logo that had a child announce the name, which is a good idea. I bet you so many people were calling this company DIC Entertainment back then.
After the success of the film, Filmation attempted to work with Columbia to make an animated series based on the movie, but Columbia instead went with DIC.
It would make a good laugh, but judging that decision alone, this company was getting serious. Also in 1987, DIC established a home entertainment division called DIC Video. Their material was distributed by Good Times Home Video, or Golden Books, whatever material was being licensed to those two companies. There's one show I want to mention that was produced that year, and that was The Adventures of Teddy Ruxpin, based on the- That thing is creepy as fuck! Yeah, this show was based off that toy from a defunct toy company called World of Wonder, and boy do they have a history around them. It was founded by ex-Atari employees in 1980, with their most profitable product being a brand of phaser gums called Laser Tag, with the sport being associated with that name ever since. You probably wonder why in the hell would they be bankrupt after that? Well, I'll tell you. In 1987, a 19-year-old man named Leonard Falcon was shot and killed in Rancho Cucamonga, California, by a sheriff's deputy after witnesses saw him and several friends playing with it, mistaking the toys for real guns. The deputy who shot him quit his job soon afterwards. According to some sources, the negative publicity associated with the incident contributed to World of Wonder's bankruptcy and dissolution the following year, with the fad of the game wearing off later on. Anywho, back to Teddy Ruxpin. It's basically another standard DIC adventure series, with cute characters going against a big bad villain, who's kinda goofy. I'd say this is like Rainbow Bright, except it's not that bright. The show lasted 65 episodes and was the final DIC show to be distributed by LBS. LBS would focus solely on live action programming, specifically those from Mark Goodson Television Productions, D.L. Taffner, and Columbia Pictures Television. Their last hurrah would be Baywatch, which they would distribute in first-run syndication until being acquired by All American Television. The successor company is now Fremantle Media. DIC retains all the rights to shows that were distributed by LBS. LBS deserves more recognition than it should, because if it wasn't for them, then DIC wouldn't have had such a foothold in America as it did in the 1980s. By the time of DIC parting ways with the syndicator, DIC had shows on all three major networks on Saturday mornings, 6 half hours of shows, and 50 half hours per week in syndication. Now that's something. 1988 was another transitional year for DIC. Every single show from 1987 was canceled, leaving Kissy Fur and the Real Ghostbusters the only leftover shows in production, mainly because the shows were not controlled by DIC. DIC was ready to roll out five other shows this year, with four of them being Alf and Alf Tales, Cops, the animated show, not the well-known live-action series that's unrelated, and the continuation of the NBC series Alvin and the Chipmunks, now being renamed as The Chipmunks. Cops was the first DIC series to be distributed by Classic Television, as the two companies would have a close relationship within the next few years. Alf, the animated series, was a prequel of the live-action Alf series, as it takes place on Alf's home planet, Melmac. The Chipmunks was commissioned by Bagdasarian Productions and was not considered to be part of the existing syndication package that was being distributed by Lorimar Telepictures. All these shows mentioned, except for Cops, were not wholly owned by DIC, and this trend would continue for the company until at least the early 2000s. That's one of the perks of producing licensed programming, folks. Also in 1988, DIC arranged a deal to merge with Computer Memories Incorporated, a former computer component manufacturer and then public shell company. It was their opportunity to become a publicly traded company. Unfortunately, a dissident Computer Memories shareholder scuttled the deal in February. 1988 also began the year when DIC started outsourcing their animation to Korea and Taiwan, after the rate for outsourcing animation in Japan increased by 40%. DIC couldn't afford this since they were an independent animation company, but Disney and Warner Brothers could. From this point on, the animation quality has dipped significantly.
Hey kids, it's time for the Beanie and Cecil Show!
Hey Cece, that's us!
What are we waiting for?
There's one show I have to mention before moving on, and that's The New Adventures of Beanie and Cecil, based on the characters created by the legendary Bob Clampett. The show was produced by DIC in association with Bob Clampett Productions and ABC, and was held by the man himself, John Kricfalusi. John K. was a student of Clampett and also worked with Ralph Bakshi on The New Mighty Mouse. And he was a rising star in the field of television animation, but alas, the show had a troubled production. ABC had been negotiating for the production of the show with the Clampett family, who insisted that John Kricfalusi would be part of the production. The long negotiations delayed the start of production to mid-July, causing much of the animation to be rushed in order to meet the September deadline. Tensions rose between Kricfalusi and ABC over the tone of the show, leading to an uncomfortable atmosphere for the show's crew. The more ABC strove to soften the show, the more Kricfalusi pushed for shocking and offensive material. The Clampett family were ultimately not very happy with the cartoon, but remained supportive of Kricfalusi. ABC canceled the show after a handful of episodes as they found the humor not suitable for children's programming. Five episodes have aired, while the remaining three remain locked in the vault. Ouch. This is arguably the first total misfire from DIC since Wolfwalk TV, as they backed ABC on the decision to tone down the show. John K. said, "Bye, bitch!" and he moved on. A year later, he founded Spunko and began work on his next project, which would become Ren and Stimpy. That show, along with other shows, spearheaded a movement that was deemed to be called television animation's Silver Age, an age where DIC would have the most trouble living in. So the moral of the story is, if you kick the dog, then the dog will bite back. ...1989 was an interesting year for DIC. They continued to shit out animated cartoons that were licensed to them. In this same year, Hanna-Barbera's popularity began to wane significantly, as they were getting used to their new owner, Great American Broadcasting. Oh, and Filmation began to close its doors. Thank God. This was the year when Dick-Ass Entertainment, or DIC Animation City, began to make like Bruce Springsteen and Rise Up. Come on. Okay. But by this time, they really made the phrase quantity over quality seem like an understatement. Kissy Fur, Ghostbusters, Cops, and Alf are left over from last year, while seven new shows will make their debut in this year. And oh boy, I I can't wait to cover the two of them. The five series worth mentioning are Ring Raiders, The Karate Kid, Camp Candy, starring John Candy, and what is known as the second series of the franchise, more new episodes of G.I. Joe, with brand new characters reboot. Oh, and Maxie's World. Three of the series mentioned were unsuccessful, while Candy and Joe remained on the air for three more seasons. And now, it's the moment that I've been waiting for. The show that will remain in infamy as one of my biggest guilty pleasures of all time. Roll it, Smokey.
Hey, paisanos, it's the Super Mario Brothers Super Show!
With Mario. Ah, yes, the Super Mario Brothers Super Show. A show that is not supposed to be taken seriously. This show... oh, Lord. This show was the first program that Nintendo commissioned in hopes of introducing a new audience to their video games. I mean, why did they need to? Nintendo was already kicking ass in the 80s. They turned kids away from the tedious routine of watching crappy cartoons and involved them in a world of pixelated glamour. They were so successful that they didn't need to make a shitty good-for-nothing cartoon featuring their most popular character. But thank God they did, because this show is a stinky turd sent from God himself. Just take a look at the clip from the first episode.
As we always say, neatness counts.
That's right, Mario. And by the way,
move a little piece of spaghetti on your overalls.
You, Luigi.
The stuff they're getting away with on kids' shows these days.
Yeah, I'm not sure how they got away with that. As you can see, the show is divided into two segments. A live-action segment and an animated segment. The live-action segments had guest stars that were popular during the era, with stars like Jim Lang, Vanna White, Danica McKellar, Donna Douglas, Magic Johnson, Roddy Piper, Ernie Hudson, and Cyndi Lauper. Damn, I bet you they spent most of the budget on booking these stars. It doesn't go without mentioning the stars of the show. Veteran actor Danny Wells as Luigi and the legendary WWF star Captain Lou Albano as Mario. I tell you, these guys own their roles, no matter how shitty their lines are. They star in both the live action and animated segments, and the live action segments are just as entertaining.
You must be improving, man, because you're bringing the house down.
The rest of the cast are veteran voice actress Jean Elias as Princess Toadstool, John Stalker as Toad, and Harvey Atkin as King Koopa. And why the fuck is he green? Hell, in promotional art, he's orange. So why did they make him green? Is it because they look at the sprites? He has an orange face! Anyways, that's not the issue here. It's the glaring animation problems that the series has. At various times throughout the show, there will be switched voices, color code errors, and pace problems where the show desperately needs to be edited.
Good thing we used the extra pipe for this Koopa catcher, huh, Mario?
And the writing. This is the cutest writing I have ever seen in the DIC show. The show is plagued with Italian food puns.
Holy ravioli!
We're sure in deep spaghetti.
Pastorific, my paisanos!
Leaping lasagna! Strobing stromboli!
Patty cake, patty cake, pasta man! Give me pasta power as fast as you can!
Get it? Because they're Italian! Oh my god! This show also has an array of problems with the lore. They seem to mistake that with the Super Mario Brothers, you can put them anywhere. That's not true. Some episodes come off as incredibly awkward and downright insane. I remember one episode where they help out some knockoff character called Indiana Jones. And oh my god, he doesn't have a face. They forgot to animate his fucking face. Oh my god, what is this? What the fuck is this? They forgot to animate his face? Look! 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 How the hell would they miss something like that? Like, oh my god, was that intentional? Look! 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 Holy shit! Just talking about the show doesn't give away the full experience. This show literally has to be seen to be believed. This show is insane, weird, and downright stupid. And that's why I fucking love this show. It's pure cheese done unintentionally right. This King of the Golden Turds was broadcast in syndication on most Fox stations and ran for 65 episodes. This was the only Deke show to be distributed by Viacom. And after seeing this, then I will only see why. Oh damn. There's one thing I forgot to mention, and that's the Legend of Zelda segments on this show, which were shown every Friday. They would be summed up in one sentence.
Well, excuse me, princess.
Well, excuse me, princess. Well, excuse me.
Welcome to Video Land.
And now we have one more Nintendo show to talk about before moving on to the next decade. And that's Captain N, the Game Master. Unlike the previous series, I didn't enjoy this one. It's another generic Deke Adventure series with even more glaring animation problems than the other ones, like Simon Belmont's derp face and the scenes with the missing backgrounds. The show stars a kid named Kevin Keen as the titular character. Guess who he's voiced by?
Canadians are weird.
Yup, Matt Hill. The show also stars bastardizations of existing Nintendo characters like Mega Man and Simon Belmont, and some other girl I don't care about. The main villain of the show is Mother Brain, voiced by Levi Stubbs from the Four Tops. Seriously? It's like if Gargamel from the Smurfs was voiced by James Brown.
Fuck home! Huh. Think we wanna sweat? Gonna catch the Smurfs! Who wanna tell that?
Anyways, this show is crap. The animation is bad, the stories are mediocre, the voice acting is annoying, and it's just another glorified commercial for Nintendo. This show lasted for 3 seasons on NBC before being purged to make room for live-action team sitcoms. Go figure. And with that, thus ends the first decade of Deke. To be retrospective here, I have never seen a company grow this fast. It took 5 years for this company to become the number one television animation producer in the United States, a feat that is to behold. There were a few bumps in the road here and there, like the Deke Saban fiasco that tarnished the relationship between Andy Hayward and Jean Chalopin, and the constant misfires the company kept producing, putting them further in debt. But as the saying goes, nothing beats a try but a fail, and that's exactly what Deke did, and they were successful while the success lasted. However, throughout the next decade, Deke will not be able to replicate the success that they had in the previous, as things were starting to change with time, and time was going fast. So in order to keep things going for the company, Prudential Insurance, one of the shareholders in Deke Animation City along with Hayward, acquired additional equity while increasing its debt capacity. According to Hayward, the new cash and debt would allow Deke to attract top talent and take advantage of new technologies. I certainly hope so. Even though this was the first year of the new decade, the year 1990 wasn't that ceremonious. Camp Candy, Captain N, G.I. Joe, and Ghostbusters were the only holdovers from the previous decade, as Casey Fur was finally canceled by NBC. 5 more shows made their debut this year, and all but one would even last, one of which isn't even controlled by the company. The 3 series from the batch worth mentioning are The Wizard of Oz, New Kids on the Block, and The Power Team, which are animated segments from Video Power, a Saban-produced block featuring video game franchises from Acclaim Entertainment, another company that should have a rise and fall special of its own. Remember the Super Mario Bros. Super Show? Well, that actually proved to be a moderate success for Deke. How? Don't ask me. Deke and Nintendo decided that it would be best to continue their relationship with their properties. So what better way to put the brothers with the Game Master himself, Captain N? Well, not exactly, but they were merged together in the same time slot, kinda like what Hanna-Barbera did with Scooby-Doo and Dynamite. The latest Mario game to come out was Super Mario Bros. 3, and it was a massive success, and rightfully so. Super Show took elements from Mario 1 and Mario 2 USA, so what better way to shift focus from those two games into the latest hit? Thus, we were given The Adventures of Super Mario Bros. 3, What a spectacular name that doesn't make any sense. Why don't we just drop the 3 and just call it a day? Anyways, to sum it all up, this iteration carries over the problems that the previous series had, which could be a good thing because I enjoyed the mozzarella cheese that fermented the entire production of the show. Unfortunately, it had none of that. These stories actually took themselves too seriously, and as a result, it had lost the charm that the previous series had. There was no sense of fun in this series, which makes it quite boring. The series features Mario and Luigi living with Toadstool inside their house, along with Toad. Why are they living together in a Smurf mushroom house while she should be ruling her kingdom? Absolutely no fucking clue. King Bowser, Koopa, is back, with the Koopalings as his new underlings. Because Deke is oblivious to the point that they already had names, the Koopalings have very different names from the game itself. There's Bully, Big Mouth, Cootie Pie, Cheaty, Hip Hop, Cookie, Ricky, Nicky, Dicky, and Dawn. And a Warner sister. They aid Double K into his schemes to capture the princess and take over the Mushroom Kingdom. The main reason why I can't stand this iteration is because of two things. The animation is horrible. It's choppy, poorly executed, and takes your viewer out of the moment. No mean to channel Chef Ramsay again, but just look at it!
Think they'll ever learn that lesson in the real world?
Yeah, when humans get as smart as mushrooms.
I will eat your fucking soul!
Forced morals are also a problem too. But that's a main problem for almost every Deke show at this point in time. The other main reason is that Captain Lou Albano and Danny Wells didn't come back. They weren't just the main stars of the previous show, they were the show! They weren't the only ones replaced. American VA Jeannie Elias was shoved aside in favor of a younger talent named Tracy Moore. She did good, but that's not the problem I'm glossing over, which is Lou and Danny getting canned. What happened to that statement that Annie Hayward said that Deke was supposed to attract top talent? That's bullshit because they were already doing that before. Don't promise things you can't deliver. God! Walker Boone and Tony Rosado tried to recreate the roles, but goddamn they tried. They can't capture the wit and dynamic that Danny and Captain Lou had.
Hey Luigi, you ever notice how clouds can look like other things? Like that one over there looks sort of like the princess.
Yeah, sure does, Mario. And that one looks like Aunt Maria.
Okay.
I'm not saying that Super Show was a masterpiece. It was shit, but it was good shit. This show is pure shit. Nothing good's about it. It's just boring. This piece of crap aired on the National Broadcasting Company from September 8th to December 1st and was re-ran until 1991. Ugh, I need a V8.
Greatest champion, Captain Planet.
As a matter of fact, give me two V8s! The next program I want to discuss is, of course, Captain Planet. The show was made during a certain fad in the early 1990s. It seems like being environmentally conscious was all the rave, even though the people who preached just that were doing the exact same things that they preach against.
Miss Hillary, did you have a good time at the Save the Everglades fundraiser?
Jeffrey, these events are not about having a good time. They're consciousness-raising experiences. When you hear about all of the species that are on the brink of extinction, it's grim, grave, and very, very sobering. Tom Cruise was near tears. Oh, wasn't he gorgeous?
And yes, this was the only media-related project that Ted Turner ever created. Let that sink in for a moment. The premise of the series is Gaia, the spirit of the planet, is wakened from a long sleep by Hawkish Greedley, who happens to be drilling above her resting chamber. Realizing that the damage is extensive, Gaia sends 5 magic rings, 4 with the power to control an element of nature and 1 controlling the element of heart, to 5 chosen youths across the globe. Kwame from Africa, Wheeler from North America, Linka from the Soviet Union, later changed to Eastern Europe after the Soviet Union's dissolution, G from Asia, and Mati from South America. In situations that the Planeteers cannot resolve alone, they combine their powers to summon Captain Planet, a superhero who possesses all the powers magnified, symbolizing the premise that the combined efforts of a team are stronger than its individual parts. Captain Planet only appears in his Captain Planet garb. These are not clothes, but elements of the planet that are integral to his composition. Captain Planet's outfit represents the embodiment of the beauty of a beautiful, better environment. A grass-green portal mullet, crystal blue skin, earthy brown eyes, a fire-red chest, gloves, trunks, and boots, and a sunny yellow globe insignia.
Ha! Gay!
Oh, color me stupid, because this premise sounds ridiculous. And it is! I'm not going to review this show because it's pretty much what you expect. The show follows the same song and dance. Captain Planet appears in every episode. The kids don't use logic when it's clearly needed in the story. They're merely just pawns of it. There's no characterization, no excitement, no butterball cheese, just flashy South Korean animated eye candy in disguise of an environmental PSA. If you want to see what happens when a media mogul creates a cartoon and not well-deserving talent that needed a breakthrough, then the show's for you. Captain Planet is notable for being the first animated program that Turner produced and distributed. It premiered on TBS on September 15th and lasted until 1992, when Turner terminated their contract with DIC for producing animation for the series. A new series premiered a year later, which was produced by the newly purchased Hanna-Barbera production company. ...1991, the year where Nickelodeon premiered their lineup of cartoons that were deemed to be called Nicktoons. That same year, NBC, where DIC broadcasted a significant amount of their programs, was getting ready to phase out cartoons due to the success of Saved by the Bell. And Hanna-Barbera, DIC's main competitor, was acquired by entertainment mogul Ted Turner through his Turner Broadcasting System, which was DIC's client on Captain Planet. These three events would develop a rain cloud over the offices of DIC Animation City, as they had the potential of destroying all the progress that DIC made within the last 8 years of its inception. With all this in mind, DIC had a solution. Produce more programs. Bump up all the production within the company, even if the quality of the shows had to take a nosedive. Not that there was much quality in the shows to begin with, but who cares? Anyways, more production! This strategy was created in hopes for DIC to at least get something out of it, whether it would be a hit in the vein of the real Ghostbusters and Inspector Gadget. This resulted in the debut of 9 new series for the production company during the year. And that's insane. Out of all of these series, I'm only going to touch on one of them. But first, we got to mention the 8. They were Chip and Pepper's Cartoon Madness, Swamp Thing, Hammerman, Where's Waldo, Wish Kid starring Macaulay Culkin, Pro Stars, the second season of Bill and Ted's Excellent Adventures, taking over production from Hanna-Barbera, and the UK-exclusive series Captain Zed and the Z-Zone. All of these shows, including the one I'm going to mention, were canceled. Yep, that's right. They were canceled within the same year. Cue the horns, fellas! Oh my god, how can this company survive?
Super Mario World.
The one show I want to briefly mention is the third iteration of the Super Mario Brothers cartoon, Super Mario World. Some of the problems from the previous series were ironed out, like the animation issues, but the show is still boring. The cast is carried from the previous series as well as the animation crew. Toad is phased out in favor of Yoshi, who is so freaking adorable in the show. I mean, look at him, he's so cute. Oh yeah, and some caveman character we don't know about. He looks like a cross between Beavis and Neil Patrick Harris. There are some design and naming issues as well, because DIC really didn't care, like always. First off, Toadstool looks pale as fuck. I guess they recognize that she's ginger, and when she's not. The Koopalings, or the Koopa Kids, whatever the fuck you want to call them, still have their stupid nicknames. And there's no Ricky, Nicky, Dickie, and Dom because they were phased out too. Wait, they weren't actual shows to begin with? Then why didn't you tell me? Derp!
Dumbass!
And there's also the most glaring problem. Bowser still looks the same as his NES counterpart. And he's still called King Koopa. Good God! Did they play the actual game? Did you do any research? No, because he didn't care! Oh, and the animation is mediocre, the writing is subpar, and the overall show sucks. The difference between these batch of shows and the previous ones, other than the fact that they were all failures, was the fact that they were all network shows. Since DIC was nothing but a shell of its former self, they couldn't secure a show to be syndicated during that year. Gee, probably due to the fact that they couldn't hold a syndication partner for long. The program exchange were content with the amount of shows they had, so they didn't need any more for the time being. Classic Television didn't need any more shows from DIC either. That really put the company in a hard place, giving them no potential room to grow. The amount of cancellations also amassed the company with a lot of debt. In April of 1992, DIC had to retire a significant portion of that debt with Prudential Insurance. In that same time frame when DIC had to forgive its debt load, Cartoon Network made its debut. It was established by Ted Turner to broadcast his massive library of animated programs. What in turn would prove to be another massive threat to DIC. This meant that they had to come up with a hit and fast. Now that we're in 1992, DIC had to see two of their last series from the 1980s. Hasbro's G.I. Joe and Columbia Pictures' The Real Ghostbusters, then renamed Slimer in The Real Ghostbusters, end their run. These two series stopped production before the fiasco in 1991. So in hindsight, DIC had a clean house, and they didn't like it. To add another problem to the shit pile, they only had two series lined up to premiere in 1992, which were Stunt Dogs and Super Dave, Daredevil for Hire. You know, the usual DIC crap. They were all unceremoniously canceled within the same year they made their debuts. Which leaves us nothing to talk about during this year. Oh wait, they made four TV specials this year. Damn it. Okay, so they made four TV specials this year based off Inspector Gadget, one video game nobody cares about, a racist ass wrestler, and wait a minute, they made Battletoads? I gotta watch it! Good God, that show was awful! Three teens turn into frogs to battle an evil, power-hungry psycho lesbian, bound on conquering the universe, a goddamn nerd who can't use a computer, poor voice acting, animation, and overall production design, unfunny jokes, predictable story, they have it all, folks, in an unsuccessful attempt to cash in on the popularity of the Teenage Mutant Ninja Turtles. You see, it's shows like this which are the reason why DIC failed so hard. They were bland, boring, predictable, and downright stupid. I have to say that DIC deserved to fail because they certainly weren't learning from their mistakes. They let me down so hard that I've basically given up hope for them. They deserve to continue in a downward spiral. 1992 has to be the year where the final nail in the coffin will shut their asses in the dark. Because things certainly weren't looking good for them. Andy Hayward wasn't doing a good job running the company he took over from Jean Chalopa, and neither were his cohorts either. There was one last thing he could do in order to secure the company a more stable future. A sale. Andy Hayward didn't want to sell DIC. He had been in talks with various parties over the past 2 years regarding an outright sale of the company. One of them was PolyGram. That fell through because, well, PolyGram knew how much of a risk taker DIC was, and how reckless they were with that risk taking. He eventually found out that selling the company wouldn't be possible. Not because it wasn't valuable, because it was. Andy loved DIC like it was his baby, sort of. He was an ambitious businessman who wanted DIC to be number one, regardless of the type of moves he wanted to take. Therefore, what he wanted was a strategic partnership with another company with capital that would give his company a push for more potential. What did you think he was going to do? Katzenberg it? Nah, not yet. Finally, in early 1993, DIC had found a potential buyer. And you heard those three letters that was brought up many times before in this special. Not NBC, not CBS, not TMS, not PMS. No, it's ABC. DIC and ABC initially worked out an arrangement that would give DIC a bigger distribution network than ever before. The problem was that DIC feared that the news would give a reason for their other biggest client, CBS, to turn away from them in favor of other animation providers. In which they eventually did. After the ABC news, CBS dumped DIC in favor of Nelvana and Walt Disney Television. Ouch. Anyways, the DIC ABC joint venture became known as DIC Entertainment Limited Partnership, the name of which would stick with DIC for the rest of its days, minus the LP. DIC Animation City itself initially would remain independent, according to the press release. But somehow along the line, DIC Animation City got integrated into DIC Entertainment, thus making the ABC acquisition a reality. As much as Hayward didn't want it, I'd say the acquisition was welcome for DIC, since they like to risk-take a lot with no positive results. Somebody's finally there to regulate them and put them back into shape, and with ABC as their new owner, that's a good way to look for it and say, "Here I am, world, come and take me." 1993 will also be the year where DIC would have another stable syndication partner in Bobot Entertainment. Their relationship reached as far back as the late 80s, when they syndicated cartoons that nobody gave a shit about. But now, Bobot launched another syndicated cartoon block called BKN, the Bobot Kids Network, and DIC was one of the principal partners in the network. Most of their programming in the mid-90s were broadcasted on the block, and on ABC as well. Let's see how well DIC does in good old 93. DIC rolled out 6 new shows this year. An all-new continuation of Dennis the Menace aired on CBS that year. Only 13 episodes were produced. Next, the BKN shows Hurricanes and video game adaptation Double Dragon made their debut. They were successful enough to be warranted new season orders. Hurricanes was a co-production with Scottish Television, so it was successful over there. That show warranted a 65-episode run. Double Dragon, on the other hand, had 26 episodes produced, and I can see why. The show is crap as usual, but it's nice to see that DIC finally got their hands on a renewal. Before I get my ass handed to me, Madeline is the other show that premiered that year, but I want to talk about that later, because DIC had a weird continuity problem with the license when it came to production. Right now, we are going to shift our focus into 2 new shows that have an important foothold in DIC's history, and they both star a blue speedy hedgehog named Sonic. Yeah, DIC made 2 Sonic shows concurrently, and it wasn't on accident either. Right around the time The Adventures of Sonic the Hedgehog, or AOOF, as y'all like to call it, was about to finish production, ABC commissioned a Sonic series of their own. 2 different teams worked on these series. One featured a lighthearted tone, and the other featured a darker and more serious tone. Let's take a look at the first iteration of Sega's mascot, AOOF.
Pingas!
Alright! The Adventures of Sonic the Hedgehog features our favorite titular Speedy Speedster and his golden-furred two-tailed sidekick, Tails. They run about thwarting the plans of the evil mechanic wizard and loudmouth fatty himself, Dr. Julian Robotnik. Julian? Isn't it supposed to be Ivan Robotnik? What the fuck am I talking about anyway? You know, I know that Deke doesn't really care about names, so what the fuck ever. Anyways, Robotnik's plans usually focus on dominating planet Mobius and establishing order with his stupid-ass robots, the 2 noticeable ones being Scratch, whose voice sounds like Gilbert Godfrey getting his balls grinded by a cheese grater.
Not me! I didn't hear nothing about Von Schlemmer's dream-a-magic!
I can't believe it! I just don't believe it!
And Grounder, the prototype of Patrick Starr.
Me neither! Especially I didn't hear the part about the clown!
Pingers!
These 2 are the most dumbass sidekicks I've ever seen in a DIC cartoon, and they play it off well without beating a dead horse. And now to the review. This show is stupid. Beautifully stupid. And let me tell you, I loved it.
Pingers!
Shut up, goddammit! Anywho, this show was made around this time when stupid was in. Ren and Stimpy had shown that fact alone. This show actually makes its own mold of stupid, being significantly influenced by the Warner Brothers and MGM cartoons from the 40s and 50s. Their jokes are improbably incoherent. It doesn't make any sense, and it works!
I'm over there.
Yes, and I'm aware of the PSAs. Oh my god, these are the best PSAs I have ever seen. These messages are so god-awful, I almost pissed myself laughing. There was a PSA telling kids to not climb in laundry machines.
Did not climb in laundry machine. Who does that? That's so fucking bizarre. Oh my god. You know what this show reminds me of? Yeah, the Super Mario Brothers Super Show. These shows operate on levels of stupidity that are unimaginable. They are both based on video game properties that in turn would eventually rival each other. Their animation, writing, and overall design are so shockingly, albeit lovingly, bad that I just fell in love with it. I've had so much fun with these shows, and I'm going to watch all the episodes of these two pieces of doo-doo just for shits and giggles. My god, Deke really got back in their groove with this.
Pingers! 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 Pingers!
Shut up!
65 episodes were produced for broadcast on the Boba Kids Network. The show ran from September to December 1993 and was picked up for broadcast on USA. It was then relocated to Toon Disney, where it reran until 2002. The show is now available on Netflix.
Pingers!
And now, it's time to talk about ABC Sonic, or what the fans like to call it, Sad I Am. Okay, I'm getting carried away here. The show is a more darker variation of the first game's plot. Dr. Robotnik is a warlord, former scientist, and current dictator of planet Mobius, the dystopian counterpart to the sunny and colorful world of AOSTH. Ugh, goddammit. The entire population has been turned into robotic slaves by him, and he rules that population with an iron fist. Sonic and his team, with various unknowns created specifically for the series and the Archie comic, fight against Robotnik and his mooks, making it their priority to liberate the planet from his rule. Damn. Looking at this series, the show had something that this previous series lacked. Adventure. Kinda ironic, isn't it? Jaleel White is back as the voice of Sonic, and he must be a busy mofo too. Family Matters and two cartoons? Sheesh. Also, the voice cast is made up of American voice actors rather than Canadian ones, so roles had to be recast. Jim Cummings gives a marvelous performance as Robotnik here. The subtlety of his acting shows, and you can tell how much of a great actor he is.
Inside these tanks is a new chemical I created that my buzz bombers, under Snivelly's direction, will use to spray over the great forest and instantly kill all trees.
Christine Cavanaugh, the voice of two well-known red-headed boys, voices a red-headed female here, named Sally Acorn. She's Sonic's love interest. Rob Paulsen, Kath Suchi, Charlie Adler, and Frank Welker also have roles in this show, which means that this is one of the few in-house Deke productions to use more expensive voice actors. Great call, Mr. Hayward. The show paces itself well and never skips a beat, something that I'm kinda surprised of because Deke shows tend to be sluggish in terms of execution. The environmental message in this cartoon is there, but it doesn't beat you over the head with it. In the pilot, I had an issue with just that, but at least it wasn't persistent with it. The animation is nice. Deke had to step up their game in order to compete with the big dogs, and I'm glad they were able to showcase that with this cartoon. And do I need to say that the theme song is badass? Hands down, one of the best theme songs for an animated show ever.
Sonic, he can really move. Sonic, he's got an attitude. Sonic, he's the fastest thing alive.
There are rumors going around that Chris Jericho sang the theme song, but I highly doubt it. Overall, in my honest opinion, this is one of the best video game to media adaptations I've ever seen, and it goes without saying that this is one of the best video game cartoons of all time. Great job, Deke. That'll do. Sonic the Hedgehog ran for 2 seasons on ABC, and yeah, it ended on a cliffhanger. Bummer. The series was reran until 1995 when it was picked up by USA, running along with Cindy Sonic. There, that's a better name. The show is now available on Starz Encore Family, so go give it a watch. Oh, and one more thing I gotta mention. If you would stick around at the end until you see the Deke logo, you will notice an additional credit on the bottom that says, co-produced by Rete Italia, SPA, in association with Telecinco. Both companies were owned by Mediaset, an Italian broadcasting company. Their association with DIC began from 1992 until 1994, when DIC became a wholly owned subsidiary of ABC. The year of 1994 was not an eventful one for DIC. They only had two shows lined up for the year, which really isn't much. It really didn't matter anyway, because at this point their library was freaking huge. All they could do is sell away for reruns on channels like USA and Nickelodeon. Or heck, maybe syndicate them through local stations if they pleased. To celebrate this notion, DIC debuted a brand new logo of sorts. Instead of displaying the corporate name, they decided to dump themselves as the Incredible World of DIC. DIC. Settle down, folks. Settle down. Anyways, this was only a prototype that would be later used as the company's permanent logo in the early 2000s. DIC rolled out two shows in 1994. Street Sharks for the Bobot Network, and Where on Earth is Carmen Sandiego for the Fox Network. I'm going to say for Street Sharks that it was a Teenage Mutant Ninja Turtles ripoff that showcased that DIC can be behind the times. It lasted for 3 seasons of 40 episodes, which is really impressive. Carmen Sandiego, on the other hand, is what I'm going to talk about in depth.
Where on Earth is Carmen Sandiego?
Carmen Sandiego is another computer game adaptation from DIC, and it was produced in-house, somewhat. The then owners of the property, Broderbund Software, kept a close eye on the production and had approval rights to the script of every episode. The show was also created in accordance to the Children's Television Act, which made a referendum for cartoons on broadcast television to be educational, hence the term EI. Unlike any Fox Kids cartoon around this time, there is no violence of any kind in this cartoon. Yes, there's action, but no serious ass-kicking of any caliber. Enough of that, let me explain this premise. As with the rest of the Carmen Sandiego franchise, the show's basic premise had the Acme Detective Agency attempted to stop the title thief and her vile gang from stealing artifacts around the world. Specifically, Where on Earth is Carmen Sandiego followed the adventures of two teenage Acme detectives named Zack and Ivy, who are also siblings for some reason. Zack is the tech wunderkind, while Ivy's the bruiser and the pilot. They eventually sabotage Sandiego's schemes, but they never end up catching her. If anything, this is probably the closest thing that DIC had ever gotten to make a loop on a third cartoon. Let's see. A gentleman thief and his or her gang steal shit mainly for the sport of it, while some organization, public, private, or whatnot, try to stop them. An insanely smart and savvy, albeit goofy adversary or adversaries is put up against him or her. It's not intended to be a ripoff of Lupin or whichever Lupin's supposed to be a ripoff of, but I'd say it's merely coincidence. On to a short review. I admire this series for being a respectful adaptation to the franchise. The voice acting's great. The premise of the episodes and overall execution is well done. Carmen Sandiego herself is badass. I love the chemistry between the two leads, and you know what? This show was great. It's a prime example on how to make an educational animated TV show. Hell, it even won a Daytime Emmy for Outstanding Children's Animated Program. I definitely recommend watching the show, even if you are an adult. Carmen Sandiego lasted 4 seasons of 10 episodes, lasting 40 episodes. It was reran on Fox Family and PAX, and received a DVD release. It comes to show that DIC was definitely on their A-game around this time. They had a wonderful partnership with Bobot, created a hit show for ABC, a damn good one at that, and won an Emmy with Carmen Sandiego. If DIC's plan were to survive, then they were doing an excellent job doing so. However, all good things must come to an end, as DIC really got over their heads in the next year. Screw it. Let me just brush aside some shows they made this year. Ultraman lasted for 13 episodes, DIC's first flop since the ABC acquisition. Action Man lasted 2 seasons on BKN? Nice. What a mess. Yeah, it was a mess alright, but it lasted 60 episodes on ABC. And last but not least, Gadget Boy. it's a baby version of Inspector Gadget with the same freaking voice actor. If you're going to do that, then why not do a revival of Inspector Gadget? Gosh! That lasted 2 seasons worth 52 episodes. Successful year, yeah, we get it. Let's talk about Sailor Moon. DIC had the bright idea to diversify their content. You could tell that on one business side they want to ramp up the quality of their programs, while on one other side they wanted to increase their library to keep the company's value in check. Also, more characters equals more moolah, as merchandising always keeps an IP afloat. In order to do that, DIC had to always jump on the bandwagon, as they really weren't or even were innovators once you think about it. They were just great at bringing licensed content to the small screen, unlike one other company. Anyways, when Saban Entertainment unleashed a cash cow franchise that was Mighty Morphin Power Rangers, DIC wanted something similar to Milk, a Sentai series that also happened to be owned by the Toei Company, the only difference being that it was animated. This was DIC's first time that they ever licensed an animated property that was already produced. They've done this before in the 1980s with their own productions, but never with an outside production. Seeing that their now rival Saban had made a fuck ton of money on doing just that, they were desperately needed the capital. On the other side of the world, Toei themselves wanted to introduce Sailor Moon to the States. They loaned a license to a small upcoming animation company called Toon Makers, who wanted to pitch Toei a brand new live-action animated hybrid adaptation of the manga. Needless to say, thank God Toei turned them down. To make a long story short, a bidding war ensued and DIC eventually won the license to dub the first 2 Sailor Moon series into the English language. They contacted the Canadian dubbing company Optimum Productions to dub the anime, hired Canadian voice actors, and installed Carl Masek as the executive producer. And let me tell you about this cat. Carl Masek was better known for butchering anime to make it appeal to more American audiences. Or so he thought. He eventually succeeded with Robotech, but really didn't catch on with any other property after that. Some say his best days were spent at Streamline Pictures, but that was a whole other story. If you don't know the premise of the show, then here you go. The series follows the adventures of the protagonist, Usagi Tsukino, a middle school student who is given the power to become the titular Sailor Soldier. Joined by other Sailor Soldiers, Usagi defends the planet against an assortment of evil villains. Thanks to the Americanization of the anime, all of the characters' Japanese names were changed. Usagi's name became Serena, which is a nod to Queen Serenity. Ami's name became Amy Anderson. Rei's name didn't change phonetically, but in terms of spelling, it did. Makoto's name became Lita, because Jupiter's the god of the light in the sky. And Minako's name became Mina. I like the names of Serena and Lita because they put some thought into it, but I find it weird that they attempted to remove any Japanese references from the show. But that's not the only thing that was changed in the dub, because many things got cut. When DIC received the series, the show that they thought was just something that they made for kids in Japan was not made for kids. There's a ton of sexual imagery, violence, death, hell, even homosexuality in the whole freaking show. Japan was doing all this stuff since the 1970s. So for us to call ourselves trailblazers in innovation and doing stuff first and all that, Japan needs that title too. Anyways, DIC started to snip, snip, snip away. Hell, they cut so much content that the amount of episodes went from 89 to 82! Holy shit! They also cut content to pace the show better, leaving out some key plot elements in some episodes. That's really fucking stupid and they had no business doing that. They also added a new shitty score to all the episodes, which is just as bad. Oh, and the PSAs at the end. They're just like the PSAs at the end of Cindy Sonic, except that they're more boring and they don't connect to the story at all. Watching the show, I had a major problem sitting through an episode. The editing is fucking horrendous!
You don't get it, Molly. If my mom finds out I flunked that test, she'll ground me and cut my allowance and...
Her voice doesn't even match with the expression on her face! Why? And I also got to mention that they had to change genders of homosexual characters, which I found really hilarious. Zoe Stite was the character they changed the gender of. And yeah, once you hear his original voice, Yeah, I just might as well play this clip.
これでクイーンベリル様のお心はネフライトから離れたはずですわ。
My plan is working. Queen Beryl is losing confidence in Nephlite.
It's a trap!
I also watched 3 episodes of this goddamn dub, and I just had to stop watching it. It was that terrible. The voice acting sucked ass, the show let me bewildered with this confusing and clumsy plotting, and all other added elements are unnecessary, inconceivable, and are just plain fucking retarded. To quote Jay Sherman, it stinks. If you want to watch Sailor Moon in an unsucky form, then I suggest you check out the Viz Media release of the show. They have the original uncut Japanese dub of the show, and a brand new dub version of the show, which is well done. The series premiered in Canada on August 28, 1995 on YTV, and in first run syndication in the US on September 11th, but halted production in November 1995 after 2 seasons due to low ratings. Despite moderate success in Canada, the US airing struggled in dead time slots. The series originally aired in the US in morning and afternoon time slots, which were unsuitable for the target audience. By 1996, the dub was canceled, and a fan petition was created that garnered over 12,500 signatures. Wow. In 1997, reruns of this canceled dub began airing on the USA Network. That same year, production on the series' English dub was resumed with the last 17 episodes of the second season, Sailor Moon R, and was broadcast in Canada from September 20th to November 21st, 1997 to wrap up lingering plot lines. Yeah, this show was a clusterfuck, and Deke never made another dub ever again. It was their first big fuck-up since the fiasco in 1991. However, the show's saving grace was that it was syndicated on Cartoon Network's new animation block called Toonami, and that's where it became a big hit. Thanks to this, Toei commissioned a new dub to be produced by themselves. Unfortunately, many problems from the Deke dub persisted, in which a lesbian couple were changed to cousins that had a lesbian relationship, thus creating an incestuous duo of lesbian kissing cousins. Thanks for that, Toei! I'm going to go throw up now. Trying to recover from the failed product that was Sailor Moon, Deke really didn't have that much to do in order to recoup the costs. The dub was surprisingly cheap to produce, since they outsourced it to a different company, and didn't really make that much of a dent in the company's operating capital. Reruns of shows like Inspector Gadget, Sonic the Hedgehog, and all other shows made Deke a decent amount of money. However, in February 1996, things were going to change really, really, really fast. The American Broadcasting Company's Deke's parent company was purchased by the Walt Disney Company. Disney had been eyeing a merger with ABC since 1995, and they were eyeing hard. They were reeling in cash thanks to the Disney Renaissance, which put the then struggling company back on the map. But they wanted to be like the big dogs, like what News Corporation and Time Warner were back in the day. I would also compare the acquisition with the 1994 merger of Paramount and Viacom. The merger gave Viacom and its network a more sizable distribution network that could make their content more reachable around the world. With Disney, on the other hand, all they wanted was ESPN. ESPN is what you might call a money guzzler, a rare one at that. They alone made practically 75% of ABC's profits. And Disney made a great move, with ESPN's value now being worth $50 billion today, compared to Disney as a whole, including ESPN, being worth $85 billion. Good God. With Disney buying ABC, at least they had a permanent outlet to showcase their programs. Their Touchstone television division became the de facto in-house production division of the ABC network, and Walt Disney Television becoming the main supplier of family programming. So where does Deke fit in? Well, it didn't. Deke immediately became the black sheep of the Disney dynasty. Needless to say, the only IP Disney saw that was decently valuable from Deke was their only original creation at that point, Inspector Gadget. Doing so, they made a movie about it, and predictably, it sucked ass. When Gadget didn't exceed the expectations that Disney wanted, they swiftly put Deke up for sale. More on that later, as I have to cover the Disney years of Deke. And yeah, not much had happened during this time. It was business as usual. 1996 saw the release of Inspector Gadget's Field Trip, And the basic premise is that it's Inspector Gadget narrating over video footage of various parts of the world. This lazy-ass piece of shit cash grab lasted 26 episodes on the History Channel. That show was their only show that debuted that year, their most uneventful year since 1992. 1997 is the year where they ramped up their A-game a little. The Ivan Reitman co-production, Mummy's Alive, premiered in syndication. It was distributed by Classic Television, their first DIC show since G.I. Joe. Wow. The show was criticized for being a ripoff of Gargoyles, in which it kind of was. The show lasted 42 episodes, with hints from the series finale that there was more to come. Another season was planned, but it was canceled due to low ratings. This was the final DIC show to be distributed by Classic Television. And now, we move on to the wacky world of Tech Savory. Oh my god, I fucking hate this show! The show is literally stupid nonsense! Goddamn sorry-ass, dumb-ass, lazy-ass nonsense! How am I supposed to be entertained by this? The execution, comedic timing, and overall gags are lackluster, dead on arrival, and uninspired, respectively! And why the fuck are they using Tex Avery's name, the king of cartoons? This damn show doesn't even resemble his work! His cartoons were fucking gold! Not only was he the creator of Bugs Bunny and Daffy Duck, he made cartoons that you would look at, and after they're done, you might say to yourself, how the hell did he do that? How was he able to come up with gags like that? And the timing in those cartoons were like, goddamn, I've never seen nonstop action that was impeccably paced. Here, the timing is sluggish. There's no rhyme or reason to it, nor is there any excuse for his existence. This show is not only an obvious cash grab to Ren and Stimpy and all those act stupid and gross people out shows around that time, but it tried to capitalize on the legacy of the greatest cartoonist of all time. And for that, it earned its spot as the absolute worst DIC cartoon has ever made. Fuck! This show that must not be named. Wait, I'll come up with a new name for it. Brain Dead Useless Piece of Fuckery. Brain Dead Useless Piece of Fuckery lasted 65 episodes in syndication.
Now I've seen everything.
The show wasn't successful in the US, but it was popular in its native country, France, where they launched a short-lived studio called Les Studios Tex for productions to be made there. The show also marked Deke's conversion from traditional cell animation to digital ink and paint animation, as shows were starting to convert to the new animated process as the new millennium started on. One more show that was released in 1997 was Extreme Dinosaurs, a spinoff of Street Sharks. It lasted 52 episodes and was syndicated by Bobot as they continued their relationship with Deke. God, that fucking show! Fucking hate that shitty ass show! Jesus! By this time, Deke acknowledged that it was Disney's unwanted stepchild, but damn it, they wanted to make a name for themselves, didn't they? In 1998, they launched a direct-to-video division with Riley Catherine Ellis as their head. More on that later. This year also marked the end of the partnership between Deke and Bobot, their most stable syndication partner since LBS. Bobot met its end when they were sued by Sinclair Broadcasting over supposed failure of Bobot to purchase enough advertising on the broadcasting group's TV stations as agreed to in their BKN network carriage agreement. The suit bankrupted Bobot and BKN was shut down. The last two shows that Deke made for BKN was Pocket Dragon Adventures, a show which nobody cares about, and Sonic Underground, which was made to instill hype for the upcoming Dreamcast. The show sucked ass. The music felt out of place, the plot is confusing, and everything else felt forced. This is the only Sonic show made by Deke that I didn't like. Both shows lasted a year on BKN. Remember when I talked about Inspector Gadget? Yeah, that wasn't the only live-action movie Deke made. Meet the Deedles was produced and released in 1998, and it starred Paul Walker. Yeah, I'm not kidding. The show was a flop, both critically and commercially. And now, 1999. Deke produced and released 65 episodes of Sabrina the Animated Series, which was considered to be unrelated to the live-action sitcom that aired around that time. Both series lasted on ABC, select episodes actually. The show mainly aired in syndication and was distributed by Buena Vista. I watched a couple of episodes and I gotta say, this show is cute. It's actually your standard preteen comedy set in the junior high setting. The show was popular back in the day, and I can see why. The success of the show launched another show based off an Archie comic called Archie's Weird Mysteries. It's basically Scooby-Doo, except it's Archie. There's no pooch of any kind either to tag along with them. At least they got their Shaggy and Jughead. The show lasted 36 episodes and aired on both PAX and syndication. And now, it's stupid-ass gimmick time! Sherlock Holmes in the 22nd century! Why? Lols. This has got to be one of the silliest ideas I've ever seen. How in the Flying Duck Dodgers was this greenlit? Anywho, I need to stop ranting because this really isn't worth my time. The show lasted 2 seasons for a total of 26 episodes and was broadcasted on Fox Kids. The show was also EI compliant. Alright, now we can talk about Madeline. Deke had a prolific history with this IP. As far back as 1988, they made a cartoon featuring everybody's favorite little French girl. It was co-produced with Cynar, a name that you will probably hear towards the end of this special. The special was broadcast on HBO to great reviews, and was released on VHS by High Tops Video. Cynar would make 5 more specials until losing the license to do so. In 1993, Deke produced the first season of Madeline that was worth 20 episodes. 2 years later, 13 episodes were produced for ABC. And then we jump to 1999 with the direct-to-video special, Madeline, Lost in Paris. This special kicked off the third run of Madeline, which debuted in 2000 on the Disney Channel. Deke's only series to be first run on there. 26 episodes were produced during this run. I'll have to say, for all runs of the series, I admire what Deke has done with this franchise. They put so much care into the IP that even I was shocked at how sensitive they were with this. I am so glad that they didn't try to make this hip for the kids. Madeline is your basic old-fashioned solve the earth story about a little orphan girl that is growing up in a boarding school. Shoot, for a franchise that started in 1939, I wouldn't have suspected much. I remember watching this when I was little, and this show was actually my first Deke cartoon. Looking back at it now, it's just so therapeutic. The atmosphere is calming, the narrator's calm, the pacing's calm, everything is just calm. This is one of the rare children's shows I've seen that aren't loud and in your face. It takes its time, tells a story, and just leaves it at that. To make a long story short, this show rocks. Even won a well-deserved daytime Emmy in 2000, outpacing other Disney and Nickelodeon shows. And it's the last Deke cartoon to do so. The show received a DVD release, so if you have kids, have them watch this. It's highly recommended. And that, ladies and gentlemen, concludes the Disney era. That didn't last long, didn't it? In September 2000, Hayward bought out Deke with the help of Bain Capital and Chase. Everything reverted to Deke, including distribution rights to their programs, as well as home video contracts, merchandising rights, the whole nine yards. At this point, whereas Deke might have been successful in some areas, their best days were behind them. They struggled trying to produce a breakout hit, and were overly reliant on producing animated shows that already had established characters. You know, intellectual properties based on books, movies, toys, all that. This phenomenon was still successful. Around this time, the most popular animation was based on an already created IP, and that was Pokemon, a goddamn import. But that's not the point here. What I'm talking about is the creation of original characters. Hell, why do you think Hanna-Barbera was successful? Why did you think Nickelodeon and Cartoon Network were successful? In the 1990s, they created many memorable shows that were quite innovative, hence the term animation silver age. They were able to reap up profits from merchandising from their own IPs, giving them a shitload of capital and more value to their networks. That prompted them to create even more original content that would be consumed by sugar-eating snot-nosed brats. And then some. So, what IPs Deke had that they could collect royalties for merchandising? Inspector Gadget is one, a practically dead franchise at this point, and Braindead Useless Piece of Fuckery. They had original characters, didn't it? Well, at that point, Deke was screwed. The reason why the company wasn't as valuable was because its considerable lack of original properties. That's why Disney didn't want to do anything with Deke when they owned them. They were practically useless. One of the rare cases that library doesn't matter this time around. Not to mention that thanks to Cartoon Network and Nickelodeon, kids were starting to turn away from Saturday morning time slots, especially when most of the programs had to be EI compliant. Having cartoons broadcasted 24 hours a day on Cartoon Network was something that kids would dream up in the decades before the network's launch. Deke tried to take advantage of Cartoon Network's time slots, but they could only squeeze Dennis the Menace in there. That's fucking pitiful. Gadget, Heathcliff, and a handful of others made it to Nick, but all of them would be gone by the late 90s. Same with the USA Network. Yeah, Deke was running out of places to showcase their content. They had Fox Kids, but even they were stingy with their time slots. In these coming years, Deke was doomed to keep doing what they were doing. Even if they were to succeed at it, they were never going to catch up with the top dogs. When Hanna-Barbera, one of the final remnants of the olden days of cartooning, folded into Warner Brothers, you can imagine that Andy Hayward could only think of one thing. Deke was officially a dinosaur. In 2001 saw the release of three new shows from the company, with two of them being Alienators, Evolution Continues, based on the movie Evolution from DreamWorks, and Mary-Kate and Ashley in Action, based on the world's darling, Ew. Both series lasted 26 episodes. Evolution aired on Fox, while those Kate twins aired on ABC. Now let's briefly talk about Gadget and the Gadgeteenies. Ugh. Sounds like a name of a crappy cover band. Anyways, it's an international co-production between Deke, Saban, and Fox Kids Europe. This iteration is really not so different from the previous series. Gadget's still the bumbling detective he used to be. Penny's on his side, who created two stupid-ass robots to monitor Gadget on his missions. They're the Gadgetinis. And yeah, Dr. Claw is also in this series. And in one episode, you can actually see the outline of his face, body, and head. Yeah, good job fucking that up, dick. You don't see Brain in this series for an oh my god, what were they thinking reason. After years of Gadget constantly mistaking him for Mad Agent and trying to apprehend him, Brain is now phobic and nervous when he hears Gadget's name and has taken refuge in a shack by a lake. Wow. Overall, this show is meh. Stick to the original if you can. The revival lasted two seasons totaling 52 episodes. Go figure. Oh, and get this. This was a collaboration between Hayward, Jean Chalopin, and Haim Saban. Weird that they got to work together when they're not at each other's throats. In 2002 was the year where Deke had a makeover. They used the Incredible World of Deke ad campaign that they used in the mid-90s and made it the corporate logo. And to top it all off, they did it in a rather annoying way. This logo came off as way too childish and it alienated a lot of viewers. But enough of that, let's get on with the shows. They premiered four of them this year. One was another fucking dub that nobody asked for. Hell, they even got sued for making a dub. It was pulled off the air after 13 episodes. The remaining three are quite interesting. One being a licensed property, while two of them being actual original creations. First, we'll start with the licensed property. Stargate Infinity, a show that is not well liked by Stargate fans, as well as kids for that matter. The show lasted only one season worth 26 episodes. And then we move on to Super Duper Sumos, a show about crime-fighting sumo wrestlers who fight using their buttocks. Fuck me. That show lasted 26 episodes as well, until it got canceled by Nickelodeon of all people. And now we move on to Liberty Kids, a show that was Deke's only good show during this time period. I swear, they are actually good at making EI-compliant programs. The show followed two teens and a boy witnessing the events of the American Revolution as it happened. The show featured many A-list celebrity voices such as Walter Cronkite, Sylvester Stallone, Ben Stiller, Billy Crystal, Annette Bening, Dustin Hoffman, Arnold Schwarzenegger, Liam Neeson, Whoopi Goldberg, and Ricky Nicky the King Dong. You'll never take me alive, you sons of bitches! Liberty Kids lasted 40 episodes on the public broadcasting service. That's right, PBS. The only show on for the network. It was eventually reran in syndication. Deke and Nickelodeon had a good relationship, but eventually, things started to heat up between them. They wanted to take things to the next level, so they played some sweet soul music and got it on with Nickelodeon's Sunday Movie Tunes. It was a block that featured TV movies produced to probably showcase some ideas that Deke wanted to get off the ground. However, some of those ideas eventually became foregone conclusions of established series. Inspector Gadget, Archie's Weird Mysteries, and Madeline saw their respective finales, while Dennis the Menace and Sabrina became the de facto conclusions of their respective iterations. The rest was basically filler that Deke had to produce in hopes of staying afloat. Unfortunately, the block did not, and it only lasted 2 months. The TV movies, however, were eventually released on home video by MGM Home Entertainment. The end of Sunday Movie Tunes signified the breakup between Deke and Nickelodeon, a relationship that began in the mid-80s. Alright people, we're about to approach the end. I'm just going to give a quick little rundown of what Deke did during their final years. Time me on this one. Let's see, give me 2 minutes. Ready? Go! In 2003, Deke premiered Sabrina's Secret Life and Strawberry Shortcake. Sabrina's Secret Life was a continuation of the first animated series. In this series, Sabrina is 14 years old and is voiced by Baby Lola Bunny. It lasted only one season. Strawberry Shortcake was Deke's biggest hit of the 2000s. It lasted 4 seasons, totaling 44 episodes. In that same year, Deke launched the Deke Kids Network in association with Tribune Entertainment, the syndication arm of Tribune Broadcasting. By August of that year, 400 stations had signed 3 to 5 year deals. The block was launched on September 1st. It featured both older and newer shows from Deke, as well as shows that were not in their library, such as the Smurfs. Why do I keep bringing up the Smurfs in this goddamn special? Because it's awesome. With its 3 feeds, Deke Kids was on Fox, WB, and UPN affiliates, and outperformed the network's Saturday morning blocks by December 1st. Good job, Deke. In 2004, Andy Hayward purchased Bain Capital's interest and took the company public the following year. In hindsight, not much happened in 2004. In 2005, Deke premiered Trolls and features the adventures of 5 teenage girls who call themselves the best friend for life, who use magic to help them with their everyday life as well as battling whatever magical creatures and problems they may find themselves up against. It only lasted 1 season, worth 27 episodes. In 2006, Deke Entertainment, KOL, which is AOL Kids Online, there we go, and CBS Corporation agreed to a new 3-hour-long programming block for Saturday mornings on CBS called KOL Secret Slumber Party, which was launched on September 15th. It was centered around girls and alien boys. Combined with it being EI compliant, it didn't turn the interest of many kids. KOL dropped out of the block within a year. However, Deke and CBS rekindled a spark that was lost during the ABC era. The block was renamed Coolopolis, with Cool being misspelled. That year, they premiered Horseland, a boring-ass show about horses. It lasted 3 seasons for 39 episodes. And there we go. Wait a minute. There we go. There goes the timer. Woo! Yes. I didn't think I was going to do it in 2 minutes, but I did. But anyways, remember when I said I wasn't going to look over the live-action Deke series? Yeah, I did that because they really didn't have that much of an impact with the company. Well, except for Zubbly Zoo, as it was seen as a hallmark in children's programming back then. Oh, and they also starred Ben Vereen, who is an amazing actor, by the way, so... whatever. Deke produced 2 live-action shows for that Secret Slumber Party crap block, whatever. One was called Cake, which was basically a ripoff of a Nickelodeon sitcom mixed with the how-to segments of any homemaking series like Rachel Ray or Martha Stewart. It was lame as fuck and it lasted 13 episodes. Another show was Dance Revolution. Why do I even bother? Yeah, that barely lasted a year too. In 2007, 3 more series premiered on Coolopolis. Care Bears, Adventures in Care-A-Lot, marked a return to the franchise that Deke had been wanting to do. By that time, it was too late. It lasted 2 seasons, totaling 26 episodes. And alas, we come now to the final 2 productions that Deke ever produced. Dino Squad and Sushi Pet. They both feature a team of animals that fight bad guys or whatever. Yeah, Dino Squad was another 80s Saturday morning action cartoon that dated itself the moment it was made. While Sushi Pet kinda reminded me of Wonder Pets, except that it was more kinetic. Both lasted 2 seasons. I did it!
Yeah, I got one question, man. Tell me who next. This nigga Salt Lightning nigga who just getting the best. See, I'm the best, man. I did it.
And now we approach the day that Deke died. Around June 2008, Deke entered an agreement to merge with another children's entertainment company called the Cookie Jar Group. A little background info. Cookie Jar was the successor company of Cinnar, a company that was affected by a scandal revolving around its 2 founders. They secured $122 million in Bahamian bank accounts behind the shareholders' back, and it was alleged that they used Cinnar as a piggy bank and schemed to transfer funds out from the company through a series of complicated transactions to their own offshore holding companies. Charges weren't pressed against them, but eventually sent Cinnar into a downward spiral and it was delisted from the stock exchange. The company was bought in 2004 by Michael Hirsch, the founder of Nelvana, and Cinnar was named Cookie Jar. Back to the acquisition. The acquisition was valued at $87.6 million, and a merger created the largest independent producer of children's programs. The initial plan was that Deke was going to remain a subsidiary of Cookie Jar, or so they thought. I can concur that they were going to do that because Hayward was going to remain a key member of the combined company, but that wasn't the case. He wanted to cash out of the company, because let's face it, Deke was dying. Its best days were behind them, because the landscape back then was well suited for them. Now, with the networks having their massive restrictions on children's programming, as well as the cable networks not wanting anything to do with Deke, they were stuck between a rock and a hard place. They were doing the best they can by that point, but it was clear that from the get-go that they weren't going to last. On July 23rd, both studios completed their merger, and Deke was then folded into Cookie Jar. As part of Cookie Jar's merger with Deke, Cookie Jar acquired Copyright Promotions Licensing Group and a 1/3 interest in international children's television channel, Kidsco, as well as 6,000 hours worth of programming. Now that is impressive. So the lingering question is, why did Deke, an animation company that was a risk taker and succeeded, rise and fall? Well, we can all conclude that Deke's biggest enemy was time. Time killed Deke. When they entered the game in the 1980s, Saturday mornings were starting to change significantly. The Parents Television Council reared its ugly head and lobbied the government to do something about inappropriate content in children's television and all that hoo-ha. They complained about shows basically being advertisements for toys and not having any educational value whatsoever. Producers tried to appease the PTC with PSAs at the end of every episode, but that wasn't enough. In 1990, the FCC enacted the Children's Television Act, which was designed to increase the amount of educational children's programming on television. The act required full-service television stations that offer children's television programming to serve the educational and informational needs of children through their overall programming, including programs that are specifically designed to serve these needs. The act wasn't fully enforced until 1996, and that really put a number to Saturday morning cartoons into the 2000s. That wasn't the only thing that fazed Deke, however. The rise of cable networks, mainly Cartoon Network and Nickelodeon, contributed to Deke's struggles. Nicktoons and Cartoon Cartoons featured original characters that were more engaging to watch than your average show that was designed to sell you toys. They became the trailblazers of tomorrow, a prime example on how modern cartoons should be. Deke didn't have the capacity nor the capital to do just that. They felt more comfortable illustrating the ideas of others rather than developing their own. And when they did, the results were mixed to negative. And last but not least, Disney. The Disney Renaissance not only encompassed their movies, but it affected the company as a whole. Disney put their hat in the ring to make shows on their own, and they were extremely popular. And when Disney bought Deke, they inherited Deke, which they desperately wanted to kick out of the Mouse House. Deke couldn't hold a candle. Hell, they couldn't even hold a match to what Disney did. Here was Deke making some stupid filler shit nobody cared about while Disney was dropping the latest episode of Recess. I mean, come on! I can theorize that the Disney administration had a lasting effect on Deke in terms that no matter how hard they tried, they couldn't just live up to the massive success that other animation houses had. Hanna-Barbera, Warner Bros. Animation, Disney, you name it. When Deke launched their stupid slumber party shit on Doodoo Blue, you can tell that their time was ready to run out. It's really sad to see that such a giant that Deke was. The most dominant producer of children's programming in the 1980s, and they were able to fall so hard into the coming years. In fall of 2009, Coolopolis was renamed to Cookie Jar TV. And the final episode of Sushi Pack, one of Deke's final shows, aired around that time. Also, Deke Kids became Cookie Jar Kids Network. These two blocks were the last remaining remnants of the Deke legacy, other than their library, of course. The Kids Network ceased broadcasting on September 18, 2011, while Cookie Jar TV ceased on September 21, 2013, when CBS launched the CBS Dream Team. A block that was produced by Linton Entertainment, the main murderer of Saturday morning cartoons. Settle down, Trim. Settle down. On October 22nd, 2012, Cookie Jar was acquired by DHX Media, who was on an acquisition spree that arguably is still going on to this day. They were eventually folded into DHX, making this company the current successor of Deke Entertainment. A year before that, Andy Hayward founded a company called A-Squared Entertainment, a brand management and licensing company that represents third-party properties across a broad range of categories and territories around the world. It held licenses that Deke couldn't get off the ground. It merged with another company called Genius Brands International, which Hayward runs to this day. You know, looking back, I've said a lot of bad things about Deke Entertainment. They made a ton of bad decisions, such as mass-producing programs when they shouldn't, creating shows that weren't engaging enough for the kids, or ignoring a couple of things that could prove to be detrimental to their existence in the future. They might have not have been the best company, but they did make some great cartoons. The Real Ghostbusters is one of my new favorite shows right now. While I had a blast watching shows that were just plain stupid, like Super Show and Cindy Sonic, they also made some great EI-compliant shows like Carmen Sandiego and Liberty Kids. It goes without saying that I grew up with Deke. I remember Captain Planet being shown on Cartoon Network with its environmental messages being shoved down my throat. I remember Madeline being shown on Playhouse Disney with its sweet innocence and its calming atmosphere. Deke had shows that many people remember fondly. Whether or not if it was legitimately good, pure schmaltz, or pointless shit that shouldn't have ever been made. Their cartoons not only defined a generation, they were a part of it. Deke will forever go down in the history books as one of the most prolific animation studios ever. They strive to be great, and they did. And that's why we should all love Deke. Don't laugh at me! It was only a slip-up.
Again, let's do the Mario all together now. got it! It's the Mario! Do the Mario! Swing your arms from side to side. Come on, it's time to go! Do the Mario! Take one step, and then again, let's do the Mario all together now! Come on now, it starts like that!